All right, that's about the best setup I can get. Now I can put the gloves back on. I got so much of this grease, and by the way, I used marine grease from your auto store. I really like it. I bought something else before, so and I before I opened it, I looked further into it and thought, well, let's go with the marine grease. So here's the new gear from Little Machine Shop. Here's the plastic one. From what I can see, it looks pretty much the same. It would not fit up on the shaft by hand. I couldn't get it on there, and I knew I wasn't going to be able to press fit this on and get it to work and line up the extra spacer that goes on the other side of this gear. Again, the other spacer basically has another keyway slot. It sits down in here, and it has a keyway slot. So the idea is to get this on up on the shaft on the keyway, and so when it's in going through, this has to be inside here, and then the spindle goes through the hole and then into this. So you need to be able to put this on manually in order to make room for that, and then you'll be able to get it all on. But at any rate, first we're going to see here real quick. See, now also here's paint on the bearing. They paint these things, and by the time you play with them, your paint falls off. So you got to look at that stuff, make sure you're all clean and good to go. So here we go. I know the gear goes like that. So when it goes in, the large side is on that side of the housing. So this is what the fit looks like. Let's see if I'm even in the camera. Okay, so the gear goes on just fine. So that tells me it's the keyway that's causing a problem. It's obviously not even. Now, it was interesting, you know, when I went to lathe turn this down, I was worried about the keyway, but the keyway in here, nothing was affected. Everything was fine. You can see that it slips in there just fine. So the problem is probably the height. If I lower the diameter down here, or lower it, if I take some of the metal away, that means when the gear's on here, the depth for the keyway obviously isn't going to be as deep as it used to be, and it won't go on. So it means I need to take the keyway down to make room, since I made this larger. But anyway, that's good. So this is good. The inside here turned out nice. It actually bored out very nicely. I was real surprised. Again, I think it's made a cast. It gave me like a powder dusty surface left over. And I just winged it. I just decided, you know, we're going to try to take some down and lube it up until we get to the point where it seems to fit. And I was actually able to do it on one pass. So I'm glad to see that. I'll just work with this key a little bit off camera until I get it, and then we'll move on to the next whatever is going to be filmed. Stuff takes too long for anyway. It's ridiculous. But I wanted to put that out there for somebody who might need the information. Okay, so here's the setup going back. This is what I used. A piece of 2-inch PVC fit the bushing just fine. Actually, it was perfect. I guess you can see that. You got to watch out again for the paint that's chipping away. And then obviously, I cut it on a lathe so it's perfectly square. Then a piece of metal, right? Short piece. Now the problem was inside here, when we got everything set up, the gear wanted to slide back down off the shaft. It wouldn't stay up. Because when I machined it on the lathe and honed it out, I honed out enough to where it wasn't forced on. So I got the stem through with the gear, but then you have the bottom bushing, and it just has that notch for the keyway, and you're never going to guess where that is. So I did mark a gear. Of course, it's not shown now because we moved this with the red. And so what I did was I took a file and lifted the gear up on the shaft and lifted the black spacer with the keyway on it onto the little bit of remaining keyway. There isn't much of a keyway that sticks past that double gear, just enough to catch the spacer at the bottom, the black spacer. So I held everything up in position with a file until I got the spindle down and more, and eventually I had to switch and use a little piece of brass to get up underneath the black spacer with the keyway and hold everything on until finally I had to move the little rod. But now the black spacer and the is on the keyway with the gear, and everything's in place. Now also, I'm going to take this apart real quick. None of this was supposed to go and be so complicated, but I'm telling you, Murphy's Law, when you have never done anything before and you have no room for error and it's a brand new machine, you're going to make a mistake if you don't think everything through. And when your mind's on something to get something done, you're probably going to not see something that's going on. And one of the things that was going on originally was I had to cut out the whole housing. It was actually too big. I was thinking about the housing and not actually what was going on underneath here. And this actually, when I was trying to put it back, came forward. So I had to take this little collar off, and then there's another ring underneath, and then I had to line everything back up, and I pressed it back down so it seats. But then I made another ring off the lathe that sits in here like this, and it was just a little bit, it was just a little bit proud of the block. So now everything was sitting on that, but this was catching it properly, so that couldn't move anymore now that it was properly seated in. So it was a little tricky. And if it was just done exactly perfect, we wouldn't have had those things to worry about. But we're here, we have the metal gear in, and now we're ready to get cleaned up and put it all back together again. See you on the next clip. Okay, so we're gonna put the next set of gears up. The bottom gears are in. The bottom gear with the biggest gear is towards the thread. It's part of the spindle. And the small part of that bottom gear is obviously towards the big part of the spindle down here. And for the upper gears that we're now gonna put in, it's reversed. Now, I've taken pictures, so you know, you don't leave anything to your memory. Take pictures of everything. And also, you gotta watch it when you're taking pictures. Don't be in a hurry. Make sure you know what you're looking at. Because you can, here you can see the big part of the spindle down here. And if you look at the gears, make sure your eyes are going to what you're trying to find. So down there at the bottom is the big gear on the right, which is on the threaded side of the spindle, which is right there. So we are good, we are correct. Now you can put these in, and then up top, the bigger part of the gear is towards the wider part of the spindle. So it's just reverse. Now, one thing I found out, and I didn't do it when I put the first set of gears in at the bottom. I wish I didn't think of it, but I couldn't get the gear on. Well, it's neither here nor there. I actually had to, now that I'm thinking about it, I couldn't get the gear on the shaft. So I bored that gear out with my lathe, and then I had to adjust the keyway for it. And that's fine, but on this particular one, this gear fits the shaft absolutely fine, but it wouldn't go on the keyway fine. So instead of taking a keyway down, I laid this back down and I took my hammer and tapped across the keyway and unchecked it again. And now that's all we needed to do, is the keyway was not seated for some reason. During disassembly, it kind of popped up a little bit, which is kind of interesting in itself. So now that keyway is absolutely fine, and when you go to shift your gears, this will freely slide back and forth. So now we're going to put this all back, and obviously this is the area of the shaft that the circlip gets put on, and then this bearing has moved, so it'll seat back where it needs to seat when we go to put it all in. So there's the area that the circlip's going to clip onto when everything's together, ready to go. And this is the area that the original arena camera the original bearing is going to seat into. So watch out for chipped paint. You take this stuff apart and you know you're going to get chipped paint. Just make sure your stuff's clean. And this should be let's make sure we're in a camera. This should be straightforward. Now I'm going to turn this for my benefit, and then we're going to stick this in. I'm going to put some lube on this. I'm using marine lube. I went back and returned the original lube I got, and I didn't open it, but I was thinking about it. I was like, you know what, I want something better. And you know, because of COVID, the supplies were down, and they did have marine lube there, and I decided to get the marine lube after talking to a good friend of mine. So I'm all lubed up, the gears lubed up, the shafts lubed up. Again, the big gears going on the reverse side of what's below. So we're going to stick it in. And before I do that, let me just get a glob of lube and throw it down there. Now, I don't know if you saw this or not, but this was the original big one that was below. Why they make them with the plastic gears is ridiculous. They should have all regular gears, and then one breakaway safe gear like they got at the top. So I want to put a glove on, and I want to get some lube down there at the bottom. Just throw it in there, and then this is the marine lube I was talking about. Says here marine grease, see that? So let me just get some of this, throw it down in there and smush it around, make sure it's all lubed real good. I'll get another little section of it. That's good enough. Take this glove back off and get this in. All right, once again, big gears on the reverse side here, the lower gear. We'll stick it in. Let me check this for paint chips and wipe it clean. Put a little bit of lube on it. The smaller bearing goes in real easy. And here we go. That's perfect. So it slides in real nice. Now I'm going to use a socket just to set that bearing in first. So I got a simple socket that fits the bearing size. And we're just going to tap it in. And that's it. And then from there, we're going to have to tap the spindle in and across, because the spindle is looking like that right now. So I have to bring that across all the way over until we can get the C-clip on it. And for that, I have a little piece of wood dowel that I'm going to use to tap it. Let's see where we are here. Well, we're almost there. You can see it's trying to come through. Let me just do this. We're getting there. See it? Okay, so she's through too far. That's good. I'll put the C-clip on it, and then I'll seat it back with the circ clip up against the bearing like it's supposed to be, and then we will put this all together on another film. And there it is right there. So she slides back and forth, and that's good. That's exactly the way it needs to be. Now, why the bottom gear was so tight on the spindle, I don't know. And I don't know what you would do if that happened to you and you didn't have a lathe to bore it out. So it is what it is. I'm glad I got the metal gears, and I'm pretty sure these are cast iron. I don't know till I play around with it more, but I'm not going to go there. Now, I will say, while we're here, in case I forget, I just want to point something out here. This hole is where your lever goes, right? On this particular Grizzly mill. That's your lever for shifting low speed and high speed. When you take that all apart, it's very simple. There's nothing complicated about it. The only problem is when you take that lever out, this set screw is holding in a detent ball and a spring. And when you pull that out, your handle out, what's going to happen is that's going to drop down. I was very fortunate to see that because I didn't see anything like that on any other film. And that's what compelled me to do a little film. So what would happen is you would stick your handle back through here. You would pop your screw out. Once the handle's in and everything's connected with your shifter and your little shifter mechanism, and the mechanism is very easy too. You don't have to have the mechanism in with the gears. You can put it in afterwards. Once that's all in, you just take your screw out, drop your detent ball, it's the size of a BB, and then you put your spring in and then screw your screw in, and that helps that lock in to the different positions that you shift your lever in. So there's a little word of caution there. So that's it for now. I'm going to get wrapped up and get into the other room, the other shop, and we'll set up there and do some more. Okay, so here we are in my lower shop where the mill's set up. We're going to put the circlip in, and then we're going to finish seating this. I'll set the camera back up. I just want to show you a little what the area looks like here. When I took the stuff apart, I separated the parts as they came apart so that the items wouldn't get scattered or lost. Here is the one we're going to be dealing with. This has the shifter for low to high gear parts with the spring. And as you can see, there's the detent ball straight ahead on the bottom there. So I'll get the camera all set up. We'll get this all back together again. Stay tuned. Well, I hope I'm able to put these clips together in proper order. I just checked and it looks like we're getting to be having a good bit. So here's the circlip that's going to go in here. Once it's on there, then we're going to seat it nice and flat where it needs to be. So I'm going to set this up over here. Actually like this. Problem with the after lube and everything is, man, it gets everywhere, but it's good stuff. So here's the jar. This has the goodies that we're going to be putting in next. I'll just put them down here, and let's not lose the BB, which is right here. In fact, I'll put that in the jar here. Here's the C-clip. Let's get the spring. And this little guy, the key, small key for the other side. So here's the circlip right here. And we're going to put that right over here. Wish I could turn it up for you, but I can't because we have obviously spindles sticking around. I guess the little shoe block people made, or U-shaped block, was a good idea. So this is no good. Give me a second. So again, the whole video is totally off the cuff. I didn't intend it to make a video, but I thought it would be good for somebody. So let's do this. I don't know how else I could do it. Should have made a U-block. But that's all right. Let's do it. Hold it in my hand. Double check it. Okay, well, we're on. That was easy enough. Now I'll tap this through so this sits where it needs to sit. And that's easy enough. Get my little hammer and a piece of wooden dowel right here. And I'll just use my body weight to hold this. Okay. Then we'll go and check the other side real quick. Everybody's looking good. Okay. Interesting. All right, so now we can go about putting this guy back together again. Might as well keep the camera rolling. So I need to find the Allen for this screw. Actually, it's not even an Allen, it's a flathead. Isn't that interesting that they actually used the flathead on that? So we're going to take this out. You can see, are we on camera? Barely. Zoom it in a little bit. How's that? So we're going to take that Allen out. Remember, that's where this guy's going through when we get this gear changer all together. And there's the little guy that the detent ball is going to drop into, depending upon where you shift it. So we'll take out the Allen. Make sure we don't lose it. And then we are going to stick this in. I should probably throw some lube on it since we have so much available. It just goes through there like that, quite nice. One thing I did notice, there's no little spacer on that. Okay, guess it doesn't need one. All right, now you'll see the little hole there. That was made from the original set screw from when this guy was put on in place. And there's the Allen set screw key for that. So this is going to look like this. We can put lube in here too as well. It's good enough. This goes like this. And it just basically drops between the two gears and it shifts the gears. This is probably going to have to go back because right now it looks like it will hit. But at any rate, let me find the Allen hole for it. Yep, now it's clear. Just makes it. How about that? Now I gotta get some Q-tips because I can't see where my set screw is, where the hole is. There it is. Okay. That makes sense. All right, so how do we do this? What happens is this goes on there and flips around, and then this folds back like that, and then the screw drops in. So let me get that set up. Should probably put a little lube on that too. So that goes like that. this goes out of the way, and then it folds down, and then it goes back in. So we're there now. See, we can actually, once we tighten this up, give me a second, I gotta find my little spot and then tighten this up. Okay, let me just hold it, pull this out, line that divot up where it belongs. Something like that. And it should self-center it. Okay, now I just gotta make sure it's tight, but I got greasy hands. So that part of it's not complicated. It's not anything. From here on end, it's basically pretty darn easy. But there was a couple things I'd like to go over and show you real quick. And I know this is going to be a crappy video, but you can get most of the stuff you need to see from the other videos. Again, this was all off the cuff. So I want to try to tighten this. I'm just going to make sure that we're right where we need to be. So I know it's in there because it doesn't want to come out, but I want to make sure our hole is where it is, our little divot hole. So that would look pretty much, this would be pretty much in all the way. Okay, I'm happy with that conclusion. I'm gonna just shake it a little bit. Now I'll give this a turn. As soon as I can find a pair of pliers small enough for me to turn this with. So this will tighten that. You don't have to go crazy, but it does need to be seated. So there, that's it. She changes and she shifts. See that? Okay, now we got the little small spring and the detent ball. So the detent ball's here in my hand. See that? Drop it down in the hole. Put the little spring on top. Now yours may not even have this. That's fine. Obviously, mine did. This one goes down on top there. And then you just screw it in to put some pressure on it. At least make sure that it's underneath here. So that's looking good, feeling good. The only problem is it's nice and greasy. All right, let's move to the next step. Circ clips in and it's all the way flush. We can put this guy back together again. So let's try doing that this way. Let's see if we can move this out of the way. Nope, can't. How's that? So what we have here is a collar. And we have our little keyway that drops in. I don't know if you can see that or not. There's a keyway right there. And remember, this is the shaft that the little gear gets put on, which is this guy here. So we can put this on now. Okay. And now this gear, right? Now you'll notice that this side has the right the step up. That's to create the step up off of here. So that goes on like this. Then it would be this guy, then this guy, and then the little screw for that. I didn't want to put this on now, but we might as well. So let's just do it. Now later on, I'm going to change this. Most likely when I look further into it, and I'll probably get the belt driven set up. So I need a Phillips head screwdriver. Just to get it on there. It's not set yet, but I want it on there. I'll look into it again before we're all done. We still have stuff to do with this. As well as this. So that for now, that's good. Let me just slide this over and look at it real quick. Well, to shut the camera off. Okay, so we have this on. I gotta tighten that up. This is switch out gear is working fine, absolutely. And then this side's good. We have to put this lock and stuff up on here. We can do that now. Let's see where we are at. Let me go find it. That would be this guy here. This is where the U-shaped lock would come in handy. So we don't need this jar. Might as well just take this and get rid of it. You'll see the U-shaped lock is what the other guys were doing. This is simple, right? This one only has three parts. So here's the keyway down in here. So the keyway goes in, and then you stick your collar on, right? And then your locking nut. So let me just get a wee bit of lube. I like everything to have a trace of lube on it. I also look at the keyway, that's what I do. Which end has the mark, which end goes in, which end remained up top, so you can see the mark for the one side's a little deeper than the other. And let me get a little hammer and tap that. Okay, and this should line up with the keyway, obviously. I think you can see that. There's a keyway there. Let's see what it looks like. See, it's on. Now this you don't have to lube up. It's a nice loose fit. At that point, you can get your collar ready. Make sure your Allen's still unscrewed. Rotate it. Is there a proper top and bottom on this? No, both sides are the same. There's no reason for it to be any different. Now this is interesting because you really want this to be snug pretty good. This is a reverse thread, remember that. Now that's really weird because every now and then it does that. And I don't know why that's doing that. And just for the heck of it, I'm going to take it back out. I'm going to look at those threads. They're still good. Now I'm going to turn this around because I just want to see something here. But both ends are beveled just like the other side is. From the before you get to the edge, it's slightly beveled, so there's no difference. Oh, I gotta go in reverse. All right, now at this point, it's gonna have to be locked up. So I stuck the key in here, and you can do this later, but I'm gonna do it now because I'm most likely you could forget. I'm gonna look for our spanner wrench. Down here. Remember, it's reverse thread. Grab one of them slots. And it's tight. Alright, so I'm going to put this over here. Spanner wrench this back. So that's done. That's done. Now we're going to come back over here. Put this little trim piece on. And there's the screws for it. This is nice and flush. That's all set. Here's the piece. It goes like that. Now, here's the thing about this mini mill. This is the G0781. Whatever it is, here's the thing. I paid more money for the Grizzly mill because this is my first adventure with the Grizzly mill, thinking that this Grizzly mill would be better than the Harbor Freight mill. Well, I don't think it is, actually, to be very honest with you. You know, as I was looking through all the different mills, it pretty much looks like they're all made in China, right? So the fact is, let's see if I can find the right Allen's. They're pretty much made by the same people, you would think. If not, then the cousin of whoever else has the factory. I don't know where the Allen is for this. Must have it. Let's try one of these. And what I'm finding out is the way this was designed, there were some pretty chimsy things that I did not like, which is going to be typical of Chinese made stuff, right? They know exactly where to draw the line for weight and materials. They are geniuses at what they do, and don't think they're not. They know exactly what they're doing. So at any rate, what I'm saying is the Harbor Freight was $800. This was my cost for this mill. I think it was like 13. And you know, for the 800, I almost got the Harbor Freight, and figured the remaining of the money I could throw towards tooling. Again, I watched the paint chips. But I got the Grizzly thinking that the Grizzly mill would be a better deal. And I'm telling you, if you get this particular size mill, which isn't very, it's another thing, you know, the mill sizes, if you do a lot of milling work, then you're going to really need to look into this. You'd be better off buying a big one that suits your needs good. Here, this is a guy like me. We got in at the, I'm sure it's not the smallest mill, but I was surprised when I got it. I thought it would be a little bit bigger than it was. You know, I'm not cracking these real tight or anything. I'm just snugging them up. It's just a plate for chips, and you don't have to go crazy because this piece is nothing but plastic. So there, I'm just saying I would have got the Harbor Freight mill. $800. If that's the size mill that would work for you, then I highly recommend it. And first of all, the Harbor Freight motor has a longer lead on it. This one I had to take the electrical housing off in order to get the motor out because I had to pull the motor wire out of the electrical housing. And so that's just where it went. So this is all done pretty much. This is tight, right? See how easy that moves? It moves really nice. Was a little stiff at first, but It's going to be, and remember, when you go to shift gears, you might have to rotate this a little bit. That's just typical, because you're just, what you're doing is you're lining up a gear. See that? So that's all good. This is below. We're ready now to put this guy on the here. So here's something else I can share with you as we go backwards on this. Let's take a look at this. This has four screws, and I purposely left them there. And it has two lineup tits right there. So when I loosened up the four screws, I could barely get anything between the two to separate them. So it's going to fight you, most likely. I used a very fine ground down, I don't have it right here, wood chisel. I had to work evenly on both sides, because you're not going to get it past those tits, which lines everything up, and go completely up like that. So what we're going to do is just take these screws out all together. There's no washers. That's what it looks like. And you'll see these screws have two, you can see the post on this side when you're looking through, and that's what that is. It's tits. They're locking tits. All right, so now we're checking this. There's no paint. This is fairly clean. We're just going to wipe some of this excess grease off, just so there's no excess, because it really doesn't need anything between the two. The fine film is fine, and I'm just going with what I see here. So as far as this thing being one way or another, definitely want to check that out. And I will definitely check that out in a minute. So let's take a look at this, because it does matter. This is the mill going down. Facing this way, this goes like this. Ooh, I gotta go this way. I'm looking for something and I don't see it. Okay, I got it. I see it. Okay, line up the two tits. That's interesting. What I want to point out to you is this. These two holes for the tits are staggered, and so are the tits. That's so you can only put this on in one direction, as we just found out. Okay, so now she's good. She's down, but she's not flush. So this is where you need your rubber mallet. And then hopefully we'll see when we drop the big screws in, if we can't draw it in. Make sure I got the right one. Now, as far as these screws go, wow, these screws were in so tight, I thought they were going to break. So the T-handle, would not work with these screws. I don't like the way they fit. This, I don't like the way that Allen fits. All right. This one fits a lot better. We're going to use this Allen. Have two different types of Allens. Obviously, these are the Harbor Freight ones, and you know they're kind of chintzy. And at any rate, I'm not going to lube the screws. I'm just going to drop them in and tighten them up. And we're going to use the screws to draw this together. So we're going to try to do it evenly. So I'll get the screws to the bottom. Anyway, these screws were so tight, I had a crescent wrench on the actually flat part of the Allen. And I had this whole thing inside my big vise so I can break them loose. So from here on end, it's basically a home run. The part of getting this apart and taking it apart for the very first time was a little bit nerve-wracking because it's your machine, you just bought it. I made one handbrake out of it and already the gear broke because I was pushing it. So I'm just trying to get these to where they are settling. It looks like it's trying to draw itself together already. And now I'm going to put a little bit of snuggity force on that. See where the camera is pulling you back a little bit. So I'm going to go from here to here. And we're going to have a little inspection look. Looks good to me. We are where we need to be. All right. So I'm going to just double check that again. See that? I'm glad I did. You know, these guys that are in such a hurry because, look at that. God forbid, if something, you know, that stuff's going to eventually bite you. And for guys that are always in a hurry, because they have to prove something to themselves, because they really are being stupid. I see more guys destroy stuff because of that type of thinking and that type of working. Everything has to be yesterday. Anyway, that's done. It was double checked, and I'm glad I double checked it because I was able to seat them some more. I'm very happy with that. Since we're having a conversation, we're going to do it one more time because I got the stupid camera rolling and I want to make sure. I'm not paying attention. Okay, that's good. Put the Allen back where it belongs. This is going to be a long clip. I might stop it, get set up, and then go from another clip. All right, so here we go. We're going to put this guy all back together again. This is the micro adjustment. And this is very easy, very simple, and we'll do it. I just want to point out the fact that this shaft here, I already have it here, but the shaft pulls out. Just like that. Okay, there's two holes here, and that's because this has another detent. That's because when this is all together, remember, this works your micro adjustment. When these gears are engaged with these gears, then you manually can turn it by hand. When you disengage this and pull it away from there, then you are set up for micro engagements, which is your wheel here, right there. So when you go to take it apart, you remember there's a spring in there with the detent ball and the Allen screw. You don't want to lose anything when you take this apart. Now this is really easy, straightforward stuff. One thing about this is on the other side, when you stick this through the other side here, this pivots on an Allen screw. There's your hole, it goes through here and it pivots on an Allen screw. So this set's nut is to keep the Allen screw where it was set. So if you loosen that up and then go to adjust your Allen for tension after it's all together, it doesn't take much before this is too hard to turn. But you don't want it just so loosey-goosey where it just rolls, you know, pretty much almost by itself. You want a little bit of tension on it. So you can adjust that later. And when you find the right tension on that, then you got to hold that screw still and then snug up your nut. And the nut's just a keeper nut, so the screw don't vibrate. And that's pretty much one of the things that I found out. So let's take a look at this. So you got this here. I put a little bit of lube on that, not that it even matters. We'll stick it in like this. It does have a keyway, and this particular keyway dropped right in. There's no problem. I don't have to look or find anything. It drops right in. It slides back and forth. It was really nice. And this whole thing is very simple. So you can't stick the keyway on first. You got to put your gear on. There is no slot for a keyway on it, so stick your gear on like that. Then drop your keyway in there. Now you have this. And I don't know if I showed you or not, but on the other side are the two holes for the detent ball. Okay? So I'm going to have them facing up. Actually, I can't. We gotta go like this. Bear with me. So we're like that. We gotta put this guy on first. Now this one had four bolts. They're all the same. These you don't have to take and do anything with. Inside here was the worm gear, which was not lubed up. So I simply packed it full lube while I was turning it each time. Now mine had two washers that went here and here, and they're just washers to give this the right elevation it was meant to have, obviously from the factory. So there it is. There's nothing here. You don't need to take these apart. This thing will turn. Another paint chip. So there it is. This side would go down, right? There's this, the worn sign. It's unfinished. It just goes over the gear and drops over the gear. Of course, you have a worm gear that has to line up with this gear, so you can just turn this a little bit and make sure your washers are okay down there. Maybe drop something down there to center everything, right? And then you put your bolts through. So let's do that real quick. We'll drop the bolts through. They're all the same. There's four of them. They're all the same length, at least on my unit. This, I believe, is the G0781. Now, let's see if I can find the Allen for that. It certainly isn't this one. It's this one here. It's interesting. Once you get into it and you've done it once, you realize, okay, we're cool. It's not hard at all. Straightforward. The only difference with this stuff that I'm finding out is the spindle. You know, if you never dealt with bearings before, bearings are designed, right? and I'm not an expert either, I'm just sharing you what I found. The bearings basically are designed to be press fitted in, and so you need to have the right stuff to do that press fitting. And you'll see a lot of other videos where that information, you'll see what people used on their mill. So one thing I want to say is, when you're retired, there's a reason why people retire normally, if you're a mechanic and you've worked mechanically, is because your body can't take it anymore. You lose your ability to work very easily with your hands, so to speak. You're not as nimble as you used to be. So we still have our keyway here, just so you can see it. It's still in. It fit nice and loose. We're going to put it back. And this is now going to drop. And this does have a keyway. This gear didn't. So we're going to drop this over on top of the keyway. Now when we do that, it's going to automatically line up for our detent ball. The only difference is that the where you position it in and out. So right now it's sitting on top of the gear, which is good. Now at this point, before I put the detent ball back, I'm just going to put the circlip in. That way I won't accidentally pop that off of there and lose everything. And then these circlips, at least on my unit, were very easily to be where you, instead of springing back, they actually seem to stretch. So I squeezed it closer again, and now I'm going to actually install it. So it has its proper spring. Must be cheap steel. So now I'm going to flip this up so I can look down for the detent ball with a flashlight. Because you want, again, you don't want this to be, are we still engaged here? Let me swing the camera back around a little bit. You don't want this to be engaged, and that puts you on the back detent hole. I get my flashlight, I'll look down in there, and I'll see the hole to make sure we're there. Of course, we're over here. Geez, I don't know what the deal is, but give me a second. Let me loosen this up. Okay, well, it was just slightly engaged. That's the thing, you get a little older and your eyes don't see as good either. Take that out. So anyway, I just want to line up and look down in there so I can see the hole for the detent. Then I'll drop everything down in there, because there is a little bit of play and I want to be right on it. So here's the ball in my fingertips. Drop it down. I just moved it, of course. But she's down there. She's sitting there. Use the spring. And then finally the Allen screw that has the point that centers itself on the spring. That's not right. Yeah, so, you know, when you get older, your eyes go, right? And you can't do what you used to. Your agility or whatever you want to call it with your fingers and gripping things, you lose that. It's a real pain in the butt. And then at the same time, before you retire, you got the young bucks who think they know everything. And all they want to do is push everybody out of the way because they just are so great. So now that's all good. In later on, you'll adjust this tension So the detent ball gives you a little snap going back and forth. Let's see if we can get anywhere with it. Let's take some of that tension off of there. Let's start with less tension. There you go. See that? That's all you need, just like that. Like I said, you can play with that a little bit. But anyway, now you know about it. Now you know why it's there. So we got this all back together again. And I want to say real quick that off camera, I loosened these four bolts up down in here that we put in the other day that brought the two sections of the housing together, because I had the afterthought. Now that I made the bolts tight and I know this whole thing is drawn together, I loosened the back up off camera and then tightened them again. Because first of all, you don't have to have it super tight, but you do want to make it tight originally so you know everything's drawn together. But it's cast iron, number one. And number two is you don't want to crack it, cast iron. So I just want to show you, if we're still in the camera, this is a typical example. So now she's all been drawn together. Now I hit the end and then I'm going to snug it up. So I know it's good. It's not overdone by the sun. The cast iron's not going to crack. And I'm going to be able to take it apart if I decide to take this apart later, maybe to change the bushings. So let's take a quick peek at this. The only thing left now, however you want to do this, is the cover. So here's the cover, just drops right in, just like that. So none of this was complicated. There's a detent ball in there, and that's it. And then you had your little screw on the other side that we talked about that creates too much tension. So those things are almost like your fine adjustments. So as far as I can see, working on this stuff, since I know most of you guys are all going to be mechanically inclined, the hardest thing that I found on this was working with the spindles. Because it was all new to me. So let's take a quick peek about the spindles. We had the cover off here to gain access. On YouTube, you'll see other guys what they use to knock the spindles out with the press. This gear here, which was the gear spindle for this, was easy to tap out, but I highly recommend take the time and use some type of press set, get yourself set up for this guy here. And basically your bearings, now this is all new to me, I haven't really worked with bearings before. The bearings are designed to snap in the housing, it's all designed that way. And also the shaft is designed to be press fitted past the bearings. So once you get everything set up, what you're going to use in order to grab what needs to be grabbed and what needs to be held, that's pretty much the main thing. So now we got all this done. You know, I think it's self-explanatory. I hope you've gotten some information from it. Now we can put this whole thing on. I already greased up the bed ways. I got to redo the camera. We're going to stick this back on and we're going to drop the, for lack of better words, I can't remember what we call this. We're going to drop that in position and put it in. So let me readjust the camera here. Just give me a second. All right, it's good enough. I think you can see enough of that. I'm going to have a nice time trying to clean this camera up. So there, right? You got this. You got the dovetails right here. Let's go over this way a little bit more. So everything's been lubed up already with some lube. I'm happy with what's there. I could probably put a little bit more here on this particular one, but I think it just defeats the purpose. So here at the bottom of the mill is your little, remember you have your little lock. You can slide this up and down. This has its own little dovetail, by the way. So I'm just going to lift this up a little bit and then tighten this up. Because I want this to come down up and over the rail and then sit here so I'm above my vise. Okay. So what you're going to do, it's going to look like this. Pick the whole thing up. And remember, this is the gear that normally when everything's together will ride on the track. Let me turn this thing around so you can see that. There's your track. I think you can see that. I hope you can see that. So I'm going to put it on and up and over. And we're going to get it down here. And now it's going to rest on the stop that I just set. And for the most part, this whole thing can just rock back and forth. And it's going to do that until you put your dovetail adjuster in there. So here's your screws that you loosened up. You got to loosen them screws up. They're on the side of your mill. God, I hope that's in the camera. There's three of them on this side. You also have this guy, so they're all backed out of the way. This is in the right position to drop down. Just notice what the tapers look like. And then what happens is, this is lubed up. You got to take this whole thing and shove it back out of the way and then over this way so you can get this guy in. And it's going to just line up in there like that and then drop in. Now I already checked the holes. They're going to line up perfectly when we slide it all the way down, even with the top of this, for these screws to go in and grab. And then when you rotate this up, it takes this with it. This is the gib. So it's already hitting something. Maybe it's this bottom screw. There we go. So now she's down. She's lines herself up automatically. So I'm going to get the Allen for this. Now, once this gib is in, this is not going to go in and out so much. But you got to adjust it so that it sucks up that free play. It's not supposed to have all that free play. So there, let's see what Allen this is going to be. Certainly not going to be that one. Let's try this one. It's too small. So there's that one. And we got another one right in here. And you can see that this pulls itself in when it lines up and the screws going into the hole that was on your gib. Pretty much where the nuts were, but they're probably going to be out of adjustment. At any rate, now she's fairly rock solid, but you can adjust it again. Now that it's on, you'll figure it out when you're close to being done where you want things and how it feels. And that includes the other side where it has that Allen that we talked about for your gear changer. So you can stick this in. And pull it out if it's engaged, and now you can go up and down. All right, so there's that. You got your motor assembly. The assembly here is on. She's not engaged. Now we can go to the next thing. Let me turn this around so you can see. This guy was at the top. Now obviously it's a stop so that you can't overdo it. And then your motor comes off. Jesus, how many Allens have the different sizes have they used? that goes up top there. I thought it went up top there, but something's wrong here, and I don't know what it is yet. Okay, so this goes in like that. It's recessed. How it got spun around is beyond me. So this is a little stupid stuff that you run into, you know. It's just the way it is. You snug it up, and that's good. You can make it tighter if you want. So now you know when you go up, this isn't going to fly off if it's track. Okay, all right, then if we want, we might as well put these guys on. Now the motor obviously just sits on top here. You saw in other videos there's 6 bolts there. Mine had 6 bolts and they were different sizes as far as length. Now I'll tighten them up later. Let me turn this around, slide this a little closer to you, see where we are up here. Okay, now the other thing also disengaged, see how that worked. We had seem to be missing that for some reason. I don't know where. Oh, here it is. This guy came off. This goes on the other side here. Let's see if we can't show it. Can you see that now? This guy here goes over here like this. And so we're going to need to raise this up, because the closer this is to the top, the easier it is to push this around. This is your spring assembly to help you up and down, or basically back up, really. So I'm gonna raise this back up, right? Then this comes out, this comes off. This goes in here like this. Just a standoff. Snug it up. So you don't want to take this apart if this is all the way down, because it's under spring tension. Now that you have that, you can go like this and then throw that bolt through. Pretty simple, right? Nothing complicated. The motor was very simple too. We're done with that now, right? I'm gonna lower this back down. Still in the frame, let's lower this down. So now we can put the motor on. I'm gonna loosen that gib a little bit before we do. Just a wee bit, and I'll adjust it later. Okay, I just want to show you. So the motor comes up here, right? There's 6 screws. Now I have taped them to my bench in the order that they came off, because they are different lengths. So here's the motor. It was just like this, right? Cheap crappy gasket. still usable. So this motor is going to sit down obviously on this, and then this gear is going to engage with this gear, so you have to get ready to turn something here so that your gear will turn. But basically that's it. So it goes like that, and you can see that this is going to come down and engage with this here. Let's see if I can't get this thing squared away. I really, you know, the way they do this is, it's a lot of times they, people do stuff like it's a minimum all the time. I don't know how stuff can get so twisted. It's absolutely ridiculous. You're not even being able to see what I'm doing here. Let me rotate the camera down. I'm trying to adjust the gasket. All right, let's get this back up to where we need to be. This is a crappy shot. Okay, so if I put two screws in, I taped them on my bench in the order that they came out. So these two screws would have been here. Probably need these two screws. These are going to hold the gasket on for me. The gasket wants to flop off. Look at that. That's terrible. So let me get a little bit of lube on there. Now later on, I'm probably, since I have all metal gears, I'm going to keep this plastic gear. And maybe I'm debating to get the extra pulley system to get rid of the gears where you have nothing but pulleys and belts. And that way, instead of breaking the last plastic gear that you have, the belt will slip, but that's another $135. So there we are. I got some lube on that. I'm having problems with the gaskets. But anyway, I'm going to flip this around and we'll just work it out when we get on top like that. Okay, so the gasket didn't want to stay there. We might as well just lay it down. That's the better bet now. Let the play around with it. So I got two screws in there. We're ready to drop it in through the gasket hole. Yeah, this is really going to be a little bit of a pain. All right, here's what we're going to do. We're going to get another set of screws. That would be the middle set. So I got to grab the spindle and turn that. So now the motor engaged with the gears, and then I got to play around with the screws and the gasket. I'll get these started. This one's in already. Get my flashlight, take a peek. Actually, we're good. All right. and then the other screws. So again, these bolts on this particular one, they're the same size as thread wise, but they're different size as far as length. So anyway, I don't know if I mentioned it before, but if I could go and do this over again, I would be buying a Harbor Freight one for my needs. Parts are available, I'm pretty sure they are. And I could have saved some money. Apparently. These are pretty much made the same, give or take. I think you get it. So the stupid gasket can give you a little bit of problems. You just have to work with it. One of the things that irritated me about this is the length of the lead. Okay, and then the wire going into the motor, you can actually see where this is totally crushed from where the plastic crimp thing that they do to hold it from pulling out of the motor guts has squeezed it so tight it's ridiculous. But anyway, you get your motor tightened up. I'm going to tighten that off camera so we can get this done and over with and go to another clip. Alright, here comes the fun part. So we basically have an electrical box that mounts to the side of this. And on top of this here, coming out of the electrical box, we have our readout, which is going to get screwed down into there. Which now that I'm thinking about it, I'm wondering where the screws got to. Here's the screws for the box. Nothing has been touched. That's the actual screw for the ground. It's an oddball because it goes into aluminum. But for some reason, I'm missing the screws for this. Which is weird because now here's my spindle. That just drops down in there and screws in. I have some shims there so we don't have to wrench it so much. I don't know what happened to them screws, but anyway, here's the box. I'm going to take show you a peek of what my box looks like. There's the box. This thing is another thing that irritates me because the hole for the screws for the box, one's actually over here in the corner, which is right here where my finger is, which inside is just above, barely above the electrical part in here. So this is not complicated either once you get into your box, because on this particular unit, this isn't long enough. So you got to undo the wires, which you can see are just tabs. You have your common ground, right? And then your positive and negative, right? So at any rate, you just trace them where they go, and in my case they went up to this orange indicator guy down in here, which is the switch. And basically I took a picture of what color went where. One was above the other in this configuration, and this particular guy comes out of here and mounts right here on top of the block. And when this rotates, these magnets go to rotate, and then this picks it up, this here, and tells you how fast you're going, what your RPMs and revolutions are. And as far as this box goes here, in order to get this off, it's, you have to pry it off. It kind of, it slides on a track. This is actually a, like a T-track. So this slides this way. We can take the whole thing off, and that's what it looks like. But I don't want to take it all off, obviously, because we got these wires dangling. So let me get this in the right order, get some of this back up on track, and then we have to fish our wires through for our motor down through here and around. Meanwhile, I got to get this box mounted on the side. Again, there's three screws goes to the side of this, and then that's it. I'm going to do that off camera. And later I may change this. Now, one thing is the ground screw, right? You got this ground, and you have another ground, which is coming from your motor, and they have to go to the ground screw. So make sure you take note of what grounds are where, and make sure you're grounded good, or else you're going to have an issue. So off camera, I'm going to put this together and mount it up here, and I'm going to fish this through here. In case you hadn't seen it, in case, because the camera's a little sketchy, this wire is going to go through here. I may slide this back, and then it drops through the big hole here. And then once I'm down through there and I'm good, I can slide this cover back, lock it in, and I'll be inside, which we will attach to the proper terminals. And then this will be up and out, and it'll be mounted to the two tap screws here, where this can read it and have a proper readout. So there's pretty much it on that. I'll shut the camera off. I'll look for them two screws. Whoops, actually I found them already. There's another bin right here, and I put the screws in there. Well, there it is. So we'll do that off camera, and then we'll see how we made out. Okay, I got the box mounted to the side. You know, if you did this more often, you would have the proper tools. One would be the proper skinny Phillips that had a good magnet to it. But this head of the screw in here on the right top side was so close to a terminal that it actually prevented the screw head from sitting flush inside the box wall, which kept it on a slight angle. And I couldn't grab it, so I took another look at it, pushed it in, and I heard a little snap as it went past the obstacle. And then the screw was straight, and I was able to get it on there. So I don't know what that wire is, but it's actually not next to the wire. It's the plastic housing, the orange one back there. Just ridiculous. Just a, you know, I can't stand when they do stuff that's just ridiculous. Now, anyway, I'm going to throw this wire through here. This is your, obviously your motor wire. Again, I'm going to take this off so you can see it. There's your hole. It goes down through here. So we'll fish that all the way through. And there we go. Again, with one hole, one wire at a time, because the hole is so small. So this would kind of go like that. Now you have all this excess wire that this is going to again mount to the two tap screws here. So this goes like that out of the way. The excess wire for this I'm going to fold in the box because we don't need all that wire sticking out. So it'll be kind of like this. Let me get myself on the other side here so I can see what I'm doing. All right, let's flip this around. So you can see what we're doing here. And then this goes like that. And we can tuck the wire in, so now you can see it. But this is this casing rod hits the top of that Phillips head screw. Why it's not sitting more flush is beyond me. There's no reason for that to be up other than the fact that it left the factory that way. So that's all good. So first thing I want to tell you is don't forget the ground. Do the ground first. And I got pictures of my iPhone on this motor. This was your ground. And then you had your green from your cover. So let's see how this cover is going to sit. Just like that. So let's take this ground up here and get it tied in there. Ground into aluminum. Not cool. I do want to check my pictures real quick. Because there's three holes up there. Maybe I could see it better with a flashlight. That's the top right. That's just idiotic. So what they have here is the plastic housing, the aluminum board there that the circuit board is mounted to. They have the ground going to the aluminum housing with this going into the plastic receiving hole for the threads of this instead of maybe having a machine tap thread on the aluminum housing. But you know, it is what it is. Let's get this all together and get it up in there. Get it started. So later on, if you have a ground issue or something, you ought to check that and make sure it didn't vibrate. It's just screwing in the plastic and it's grounding out to the aluminum that the circuit board is mounted to. Another crappy thing. So now I just want to check. I just have a couple terminals here. See which one of these goes above the other. I can see the terminals from here. Everything in here is just basically just passing the other guy, just clearing it. If it wasn't for these, some of these being insulated, you'd probably have a short. So I got a needle nose here. I just want to check what wires went where. Let's check our pictures. So there's a lot of pieces, but it's really nothing complicated. You'll have problems pulling this apart. The two parts that we talked about here, you'll have problems separating them because they are really drawn together, and there's not really much to get between these two units is what I was talking about. Pretty sure I mentioned all that. Let's go to the wires. It would be way back here. Here we go. So our color wire is the brown and the blue one. Blue's on top, brown's on the bottom. That's all I needed to know. Absolutely ridiculous. You'll be in the middle of operations one day and one of these terminals are going to pop off. In fact, now that I see that, give me that. Pull that back off of there. Slide that plastic back a little bit. That's one, and the blue one. Make sure that's not sticking out too far. All right. Now, before I pack it all up, let me just double check to see if there's anything I want to change here. I would say the tension of the black wire coming in could probably pop back out a little bit because it's kind of pulling the wires. It's also a stiff wire. Anyway, that's good. We're on. They do bite the terminals enough where it just doesn't flop off. And that's good. Now the rest is just these cheap screws for the cover. And none of them are machined. They just basically bite into the plastic. We can put that on real quick. Let's just see how this is going to play out. We can tuck that in underneath there. That's good. Actually, we've got to turn this around like this. That would be nice. So that's how that looks. We haven't moved anything. So some of these things are soldered in place, which is great. So when we go in there, that everything looks good. Just should be fine. Just stick it in there like that. Used to work on the Rinnai water heaters, and you know, as long as you can see what you're doing and you're not too old where you're losing your agility in your fingertips, dexterity, you know, like I say, by the time to retire, you can't do all that anymore. Everything becomes a nightmare. So the last couple years when you're working, especially as I was working as a plumber, did my best to hang in there, and that was it. Done. So it's funny, when you go to retire, there's nothing left to you. You can't even work for yourself to do a little something. And I tell you, you don't even want to. You know, people say, don't you do any plumbing work? Nope. I don't want to even look at plumbing tools. I actually renovated my own bathroom. And because of COVID, I barely got the material I needed to do the darn job. Couldn't believe it. A retired plumber. So these, you obviously don't want to overdo it because you crack it. I got two screws for the top. We'll spin this around. Give this a whirl. This is a heavy, the mills are definitely heavy. Now the other thing I have, let's see, where are we on camera? The other thing I have is to check the ways here, because these aren't right. They'll move a little bit. They were fine when I was doing the first handbrake, but they weren't fine by the time I did the second one. We had a little bit of movement. Now I have a lot of movement. So off camera, I'll probably go in there and take that apart completely and then re-lube the bedways and then adjust the tension with the Gibbs screw. Let's get this guy where it belongs. All right, we're almost there. So that's good. Let's get rid of the power cord. Now, as far as the spindle goes, let me get this up and out of the way. We could take this off. We don't need this because we don't have anything in our spindle. This actually feels pretty nice. And then let's see if you can see what I'm doing here. This is the detent ball that I was talking about. When you want to engage this for the micro, that's what the detent ball is. So you can adjust that tension, like I said before. Right now, I'm going to engage it with this. Sorry, take it out. I keep forgetting it's the opposite. So at any rate, let's go see what we have here. Let me get rid of this cord and put it where it belongs. Definitely off here. Spindle turns, everything's ready to go. Let's see how this is going to play out. Are we on camera? Okay. Feed is down on zero. Power came on. Maybe I should turn it around so you can see something here. And adjust the camera a little bit. All right, we're in forward. Let's see what happens. Turn that off. Now let's check our speed. We were in high speed, so in order to engage this, obviously you have to it's the spindle here. Now we're in that gear. Okay. I keep it for what I need to do in low gear, and I have to look up to see what spindle speeds we need for the aluminum. And that's pretty much it. I'm going to shut the camera off, and then I'm going to hold the camera in my hand. See you on the next final clip. Well, I forgot one little thing. So this is the lower shop. This is just a better picture of it. There's the exhaust fan above the mill. It's a 6-inch inline fan. It's inexpensive, and it runs great. And it's reduced down to 5-inch, and did that to save some money. And it goes over here to this window well, where there is another fan dead center, and over here is the switch for that. So it actually has two fans if I need it. I can certainly just turn them both on, and it'll be pulling from the 6-inch fan above the mill. And also, my shop, what I do is I work with air rifles, and I Cerakote too. And this one's been Cerakoted, and this is Dave's rifle. We can get back to his rifle now that we finally got the mill fixed. So I do Cerakoting too, and that's what Cerakote on this particular one look like. And special mods that I don't share with people. But one of the things I forgot was that when you're all done, you got to put your cap housing back on that covers over the motor. So basically it's going to be self-explanatory. You have two motor bolts and this cap. What I do is I keep this cap off and I keep this off. You can do whatever you want to do, but if you keep it back on, you got the slot there, and that's for when you put it back over the entire housing. The wire has to go in the slotted area so you don't cut your wire in half. And then you can put your two screws in, which are right there, and then you'll be good. But I don't like it on Yeah, I know it's basically to keep chips out, but if you keep an eye on what you're doing, you can blow your chips if you get any chips up there. I don't like it because it interferes with me when I work with my draw bar. So my draw bar goes down in there like that, and I got spacers because I don't feel like screwing it in a whole mile. And that's pretty much it. So as far as this machine, I think it was the G0781 Grizzly. I don't know. Again, I'll say it again. I rather should have just got the Harbor Freight and saved myself some money and used the leftover money for the tooling. But anyway, it's straightforward. You know, there were some scary moments trying to get this apart. When I was separating these two pieces here, you can see the seam. I could barely get them apart. And then finally, I was able to spread it. You just have to work with it. Well, I hope this helps somebody out. It really wasn't made specifically for a good show and tell, but at least the information's out there. Thank you very much. Take care.